Welcome to edusathi.com, your partner in education. This session will discuss the concept of tenses. A set of forms taken by a verb to indicate the action or sometimes also the continuance or completeness of the action in relation to time of the utterance is termed to be a tense. By the simple definition of tenses, we are able to interpret that a tense is used to indicate the time of occurrence of any verb and the level of continuance or completeness of the action. If we remember it right, the definition of verb states that any word that justifies an action or a process or the state of being is termed to be a verb. And a tense justifies when did this action take place and right now or at that time what was the level of completeness of that action. Thus, a verb is justified by a tense in two concepts. One, the time of the occurrence of verb, and the second, the current status of verb or the continuance of the verb or the completeness of the verb. Now we'll elaborate both these concepts. On the basis of time, we may classify the verb as to be stated in the past tense, that is the work is done, the present tense, that is right now, the days that we are living in, and the future tense, that is the work has to be done, it is not done as yet. On the basis of the status of verb, we may say that the verb is referred in the very simple form, or it is referred in the continuous form, or in the perfect form, or in the perfect continuous form. Now what are these forms? We'll discuss them. Now let us justify what exactly do we mean by the time of the verb. For example, something that we are talking about right now happened a while ago. It is already complete and the time frame is shifted to the past. That is something that is already done. The things that had happened or the state that had previously existed. Such a tense is always stated in the past form. So the tense is termed to be the past tense. Another way would be when the time we are talking and the time of happening of the event is the same. That is, as in when we are talking, the same time the things have happened or they are happening or the state is held or it is habitually performed. Such a tense, since it's being talked about right now, it becomes the present tense. The third way is the future tense, that is the things are yet to be done, they are still to be done, or the states are still to exist. So since they are the things that will be done in the future, so the tense becomes the future tense. Some examples, if I say he was a good man, this is something that was present, it was something that is over right now, so it becomes the past tense. If I rewrite the sentence as he is a good man, now here we are talking about something that is still present, so it becomes the present tense. And if I write he will go to Delhi, it's something that is yet to happen, so it is stated in the future tense. Now let us discuss what do we mean by the status of work. Now verb may simply refer to something that happens, an action that a reference to an action that happens or a reference to the state that is held. For example, I write a sentence like Bob eats. Now here eats is the verb obviously, but does that mean that Bob is still eating his food? No. Does that mean that Bob has eaten his food? He's just completed. He's over with his food. No. It's an habitual action that Bob does. It's something. It's a reference to something that Bob does. Another example would be they dance. Now, they dance. Dance does not mean that they're right now doing this thing or they have just completed this thing. Dance is a simple reference to something that they do. And since it's a simple reference, it becomes the simple tense. Another example would be Bob is tall. Now, here is basically justifies the state of being of Bob, that he is tall. What is his state? That he is tall. So this becomes the simple tense. Another way would be referring to the verb in a way that it tells you that work is going on. For example, I write the sentence or rewrite the above sentence as Bob is eating. Now, eating tells you that the work is still in procedure. It is being continued. Since it's continued, so the tense becomes the continuous tense. If we remember, we used to say that verbs basically justify three things. They justify the actions, they justify the processes, and third, they justify the state of being. So a key point is that a state of being is always stated in the simple tense. It can never be in the continuous form or any other form of the verb. It is always stated in the simple tense. Third way of referring to a work is that the work is completed, it is done. Since it's completed, it is done, it becomes the perfect tense. Now, in perfect tense, the example would be Bob has eaten his food. Now, this tells you that Bob has finished doing the work, whatever he was doing. The work was eating. He's finished it. Since he has finished it, it becomes the perfect tense. Many people get confused between the perfect tense and the past tense. The difference is that perfect tense refers to the status of work. That is, the work is completed. And past tense basically is referring to the time. So in the past time, if something happened or was happening, it becomes the past tense. But if the work is complete, it will become the perfect tense. When we discuss the examples, you'll get a more clear picture of the same. Another way of referring to the tense would be that a work is being done or it is in process, but right now it is halted, that is, it is at a pause, and it will continue after the conversation or after some while. Now, if I have to draw a graph, I'll say that the work is being done. Right now, it's at a pause, and again, it will continue after some time. Such a scenario is depicted in the perfect continuous tense. Now, for example, I say, it is raining since morning. It is raining since morning. It tells you that the work is in process. That is, the rain, it's been raining since morning non-stop. But if I say the same sentence as it has been raining since morning, this would mean that the work is being done. I don't know whether or not it's right now it's raining or not, but then the climatic conditions have been rainy. Let's take another example of the same thing. I say, I have been studying since night to prepare for my examination. In this sentence, while I'm speaking to you, obviously I cannot study simultaneously while speaking. So right now my work is paused, but after this conversation, I'll resume my studies, I'll go back to my studies. Now, I was studying, that is, the work was in process. Right now it's halted and then it will be in continuance again. So the tense becomes the perfect continuous tense. A key point that you must always remember is that if it's the continuous tense, so whatever be the verb, it will always end in ing. If it's the perfect tense, so whatever be the verb, it will end in en or ed. Usually this form is termed as the second form of the verb. And if it's the perfect continuous tense, so the sentence will have a been plus the verb will end in ing. Now that was the reason we said he is eating. So the verb eat ends in ing. If I said Bob has eaten, so the verb, because it was the perfect tense, so the verb ended in en. Or I'll say I have completed my homework. Now the verb complete is ending in ed. And I have been studying. So now that was the perfect continuous tense. Been was added to the sentence plus the verb ended in ing. So it became the perfect continuous tense. If we multiply the three forms of time to the four forms of the status of work, we get 12 different kinds of tenses. Now if we have a PNC of all of them, that is permutation combination, we get simple present, present continuous, present perfect continuous. Likewise, we have simple past, past continuous, and so on and so forth. And the similar lines, we have future tenses as well. Let us discuss one on one. In the case of simple present tense, we say that we are simply referring to something that happens in the present. So the tense is, so we'll use the simple form of the verb. And if it is a singular, the verb will end in an S. For example, I say Bob eats. That was the example that we took. Now Bob eats ends in S and it's a general reference. So it becomes the simple present. If it's present continuous, the work is in procedure. So I write Bob is eating. So here we have an auxiliary verb is attached to it. So while using the present continuous tense, we'll use some auxiliary verbs, which are is, am, or are. Is is used with singular, are with plurals, and am with I, that is the first person. Right? So it'll use the first form of the verb, that is the simple verb, and it'll end in ing. And the auxiliaries used would be is, am, and are. If I'm talking about present perfect, the work is done, it has been done, it's completed. So it'll use the auxiliaries as has and have, and the verb will end in en or ed. That was what we said. So we said that verb that ends in ing becomes the continuous verb. If it ends in en or ed, it becomes the perfect. And if there's a been in the sentence and the verb ends in ing, so it becomes the perfect continuous. So an example of present perfect continuous would be, it has been raining since morning. Let's discuss simple past tense. So it uses the second form of the verb. And it uses the second form of the verb. It does not end in ing, but it uses the second form of the verb. For example, Bob ate. It becomes the past tense. If it ends in ing and the time references the past, we'll say Bob was eating. So here the auxiliaries change their form. So you can estimate the time frame by looking at the auxiliary and the status of verb by looking at the main verb. So the main verb eat ends in ing, so it becomes the continuous, and the auxiliary used is was, thus it is the past tense. So we have past continuous in Bob was eating. And if I write the sentence as Bob had eaten his food, so en tells us that the work is done, it's completed, so it's the perfect tense. And had, which is the second form of has, it tells us that it is the perfect tense, so it is past perfect tense. I rewrite the sentence as it had been raining since morning. So the verb ended in ing and there was a been in the sentence. So it becomes the perfect continuous tense. Right? And which perfect continuous? Since had is being used here, so it becomes the past perfect continuous tense. Now, let us discuss the simple future tense. It will use the normal first form of the verb, plus there would be auxiliaries like will and shall, which justify the future tense. So, he will dance. Now, he is the subject, dance is the verb, and will tells you that the action has still to take place, so it becomes the future tense. Now, he will dance is the simple future tense. Again, the verb has to end in ing for the continuous form. So, the auxiliaries, if the auxiliary attached is will be or shall be, it becomes the future and the sentence becomes the future continuous tense. For example, he will be dancing. Now, we have said that if the verb has to be in the perfect form, it will end in en or ed. And if it's in the future tense, it will use will or shall. So, the auxiliary attack would be will have or shall have. I will have eaten my food. Will have tells me it's future tense. And en and ed tells me it's perfect, so it becomes the future perfect tense. Now, logically, there is no tense as future perfect continuous. But if there's a need to use such a tense, so the rules remain the same. The sentence must have been in ing and it will use the auxiliaries as will have or shall have. Now, for example, if I say, on this Saturday, I will have been living in this house for 10 years. This means on this Saturday, I'll complete my stay of 10 years and then I'll further live. Because if I say the sentence as I will be living in this house for 10 years, this means right now I'm not living in the house. After some time, from Saturday, I'll live for 10 years in this house. And if I say I will have lived in this house, that would mean that work is done, it's over because it's the perfect tense. And that would mean that after this Saturday, I'll shift somewhere else. But this is something that is going on and will go on after Saturday as well. So I'll use the same concept. I'll put been and ing and I'll use the auxiliaries as will have or shall have. Now let's take some examples. Now, he is reading now. If I break this sentence, I find is as the auxiliary and is justifies the present tense. And read is the verb which ends in ing. So, since it ends in ing, it becomes the continuous tense and the total tense becomes the present continuous tense. Another example. She had been working for him. Now, been and the verb ends in ing, it becomes the perfect continuous tense. And had is used as the second form of has in the past time frame, so the total tense becomes the past perfect continuous tense. Can you guess the tenses of the following sentences based on your understanding about the tenses? You may pause the video and think about it for a minute. Now let us discuss the sentences. River flows under the bridge. Now, here I'm just referring to something that happens. It's a mere reference in the verb. And since it's not stated in the second form or it does not have any auxiliary as will or shall, it becomes the simple present tense. By this time tomorrow, I shall have reached home. Now, the verb reach ends in ed, so it is the perfect tense. And the auxiliary attached is shall have, and shall is used in the future, so it will become the future perfect tense. It is the time we left. It is the time we left. Now, you may get confused that since it's written left, so that means it is the second form of the verb. But there is an auxiliary attached is with the sentence. So if I read left, it is left is the second form of leave, and the second form of anything is its en or ed form. And since it's en and ed form, That means it becomes the perfect tense, right? And the auxiliary points to the present, so it becomes the present perfect tense. Piper, pipe the song again. You're just referring to something, but do it, please. So it will become the simple present tense. God forgive me. Again, it's a simple reference, so it becomes the simple present tense. The travelers could not agree on the color. Here, could not refers to something that they were not able to do something, but there is no other auxiliary in the sentence, so it becomes the simple past tense. There are certain things that are always stated in the simple present tense, irrespective of the time frame. First among them are the general rules or the universal rules. For example, sun rises in the east. Now, even if you're talking to someone 20 years hence and you're telling that this was told to me by my teacher, so even then you'll say, my teacher told me that sun rises in the east. You'll never say that sun rose in the east or sun used to rise in the east. No, because it is a universal truth, and universal truths are always stated in the simple present tense. Another example is honey is sweet. It is sweet. It has ever been sweet. It will ever be sweet. So it is stated in the simple present tense. Next thing is the timetable. So if there's a timetable, it will always be stated in 6 a.m. Now, for example, I meet you somewhere and I ask you which is, and you're studying in a college, and I ask you which is the third period on Wednesday, next Wednesday. So supposedly it is your English period, you say it is English, although the period is still, that is scheduled in the future, but still you say it is English. That is because all the timetables are stated in the simple present tense. The words of emotion or fear are always stated in the present tense. So if you're wishing someone or you're praying to God, you'll always state that in the present tense. So I say God save you or God save me. Never say God will be saving me or God is saving me. You say God save me. Let us discuss the difference between the use of will and shall. Shall is used with the first person, whereas will is used with the second and third person. For example, I have, I shall go to carnival and they will go to carnival. The reason being, I is the first person and they is the third person. But the exception to this rule is that if there's a time constraint in the sentence, the usage will differ. Now, for example, I mentioned when am I going to the carnival? It is tomorrow that I'm going to the carnival. Since I'm mentioning the time, now I'll not say shall, I'll say will. And same goes for the case of the third person or the second person. Here I said they will come along, but here now I mentioned the time that we are going to the carnival tomorrow, I'll say they shall come. So basic rule is, if it's between the use of will and shall, that if it's the first person or second or third person. So if it's the first person, I'll use shall. And if it's the second or third person, I'll use will. But if I mention the time, the usage will interchange. Now let us discuss the difference between the use of will and would. The first difference is that will is treated as the present of would. That is, if I have to tell you about the something that was ought to happen in the past time frame. I'll not say will but would. Now, for example, consider this sentence. I say, I was at the station when he called and said that he too would go to Ahmedabad. Now, for example, I say I was, so this was is the past tense, the past time frame. He called is again the past time frame. But if I write will here, will would become the future tense. And I cannot fit future tense in the sentence of a past tense. So I'll have to write would instead of will. Why? Because would is treated as the past of will. Another thing where would, the difference between will and would is that will is used for definite actions, whereas would is used for the skeptical ones, that is the actions that are still you're speculative about that whether or not they'll happen. So if I say, if I have to go to the market, I'll say I will go to the market, but if the time allows me, I'll go to the church as well. So I'll say I would go to church as well. This means that my going to the market is destined, it is for sure, but my going to the church is still not sure. It might be that I go to the church, or it might not be that I go to the church. The third place where we use will and the way we use would is that will is used in single conditional sentences, whereas would is used in the conditions which are two or more. For example, I say, if it rains, you'll get wet. Now, there's only one condition attached to your getting wet. That is, if it will rain, only then you'll get wet. But if there are more than two conditions attached, I'll use would instead of will. Now, if I knew where he lived, I would visit him. Now, first condition is that I knew. Second condition attached is where was he living it. So I knew what, that where did he live. Only then was I able to visit him. So I'll say I would visit him. So if there is one condition, I'll use will. But if there are more than one, condition attached, I'll use would. Let us differentiate between the use of shall and should. As like would, should is used as the past of shall. So I'll say that should is used as the past of shall. For example, you should have seen a doctor. You're saying that you must have done something in the past. So you'll say you should have seen the doctor, not you shall have seen the doctor, because you shall would mean that you to still see the doctor. Second thing, should is used to advise someone. So if I say you should study now, it's too late. That means I'm advising you that it will be good for you if you study. Let us differentiate between can and could. One thing, as like should and would, could is the past of can. Now, for example, you're talking to me like 50 or 30 years hence, and we are like 70 or 80 years of age, and you say that when I were 20, I could lift a dumbbell easily. Now this means that there was the ability, you were able to do that. The can is used to show your ability, right? We know that. So can is used to show ability, and could is used to show your ability in the past. So I was able to do something in the past, I'll use could instead of can. The other way, place where we use could is that could is used to request someone. If I say, could you please pass me a glass of water? I'm requesting him to pass me a glass of water. So I'll use could instead of can. If I say, can you please pass me a glass of water? That is, it does not become a request. It will be treated as an order. The next is the difference between may, might, and must. Might is used as the past of may. He might have visited Italy before settling in Nuremberg. Now, there is a possibility, or there is a permission for him to visit Italy, but since the time reference is of the past, I'll say might instead of may. Now, Might is also used to show the possibilities. Now, if I'm not sure about something and I say that there's a possibility of something, I'll use might instead of may. So 500 people might have died in the plane crash. But must is used in the sentence of order or obligation. So if you must study now, lest you fail, this means that it's an order that you study. You must go and meet Mr. Bob. This means that this is your obligation. It is obligatory that you go and meet Mr. Bob. Now let us discuss the use of has as a verb. That is, has is not only an auxiliary that is used to justify the perfect tense, but it may also be used to used as a verb to basically tell or to basically justify a state of having something. That is, something is with you. It is, so we'll use has as a verb. Now, for example, in this sentence, I have my lunch, I had my lunch, and I have had my lunch. Now, in these three sentences, here have my lunch means that you are carrying your lunch. That is, you do have your lunch with yourself. If I write a sentence like I have a pen with I have my lunch, then you'll be more clear about what I mean. I have a pen that I am carrying a pen. Likewise, I have my lunch, I am carrying my lunch. The past of has becomes, or the second form of has becomes had. So if I write I had my lunch, same thing but in the past tense. I have had my lunch. Now this have is used for the perfect tense. This had tells you about the perfect tense and have tells you about the present tense. Have justifies the time frame, whereas had is the second form of has. So it is stated in the form of had. So thus, it becomes that you have eaten your food. So it is present perfect. Another way to say the same thing would be, I have eaten my food. What if I write a sentence like, I had 8 dogs and I have had 8 dogs. Now, if I say I had 8 dogs, this means this is the tense, is past tense, simple past tense, and I mean that at one time I had 8 dogs with myself. But if I say I have had 8 dogs, this means that have is the present tense and had is the second form of has, so it's the perfect tense. It means that till the date you have tamed 8 dogs, not necessarily together, but you have tamed 8 dogs. Likewise, there is a difference between had and had had. Now, if you encounter a sentence that uses had twice, you may think that the sentence is incorrect, but it is correct because had may be used is the second form of the verb, yes, second form of the verb has, but had is the, it is used in the past perfect form. Why? Because the first had will justify the past tense and the second had is the second form of has. For example, if I had a pen, I would have written. This means that right now, if you had a pen, you could have written something. Now this had is the second form of has. So if you had a pen, you would have written. And if I had a pen, I would have written. This becomes the past conditional tense, wherein the first had is the past tense and second had justifies your perfect tense. So it is the past perfect form of the conditional tense.